Alhamdulillah, nahmadu wa nasta'inu wa nastaghfiru wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. Wa nashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa nashhadu anna sayyidina wa nabiyyana wa mawlana Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu. Amma ba'd. فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون صدق الله العظيم الحمد لله last week and the week before we were discussing about the topic of hadith. We went over the definition of hadith, why we need hadith, the aims and objectives of learning hadith. And we mention one virtue of hadith mentioned by Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes dua for those individuals who are busy in learning a hadith, listening to a hadith, propagating a hadith, teaching a hadith. Like this, in one hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that inna awla an-nas bi yawm al-qiyamah, that the most closest and the most nearest to me will be those individuals who recite the durood sharif in abundance. Ibn Hibban rahmatullahi alayhi, after recording this hadith, he says that this hadith will fall correct for those who teach hadith and who learn hadith. Who teach hadith and learn hadith, this hadith will fall for them, will be correct for them. Why? Because whenever a hadith is mentioned, we say the name of Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a person, if he was to, for example, read 10 hadith, definitely he's read the Durood Sharif 10 times. If a person has read the full year, for example, he studied the hadith for the full academic year, nearly 10 months. Imagine how many thousands of a hadith a person will be reciting. And in each hadith, minimum one time, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Durood Sharif will be recited, will be prayed. So this is one benefit of reading hadith, that a person will be reciting sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We learn from this that whenever we are in a gathering, we are in a ta'aleem, we are in a bayan, the speaker, he mentions the name Muhammad Mustafa. So now we should say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quietly to ourselves every time possible. So if the person says the name 10 times, we should try to say it 10 times. If we have missed, you know, we have missed one or two out, inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in one hadith that the most, you know, stingy person, conjuice person, is that person that who the name of Muhammad is mentioned and he doesn't say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whereas to say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is free of charge. It doesn't take enough energy, it doesn't take nothing at all. So this is one benefit of and virtue of learning hadith, that we are going to pray or we are going to recite sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inshallah with every hadith minimum one time inshallah. Imam Sufyan Thawri rahmatullahi alayhi says that I do not know of any knowledge except the knowledge of hadith, the most sacred. I do not know any sacred and great knowledge except the knowledge of hadith. Inna an-nasa yahtajuna ilayhi. Why? Because the people are in need of hadith, where in every moment of their life, hatta fi ta'amihim wa sharabihim, even while they're eating, they are in need of hadith. While they are drinking, they are in need of guidance from the hadith of the Prophet. What do we learn from this? It's an extra point here. We learn the beauty of our deen. Our deen is so beautiful and is so complete that it teaches you every single moment of our life. From the beginning, from the time, well, actually before even birth, while the person is living, and after death. Every aspect of a human being's life is recorded and mentioned, and guidance is there in our deen. It is our weakness that we do not study our deen, and it is our weakness that we do not look for the deen properly. For that reason, what do? We fall prey of, you know, shying away of practicing on deen. But when we study the deen, and we understand the full deen, we will see that this is the most complete and the most beautiful deen and the religion we have. So this is the Imam Sufyan Thawri rahmatullahi alayhi's quote, that he says that this is the best education and best knowledge, the knowledge of hadith. Why? Because people are in need of hadith in every moment of their life. Moving on to the next thing now. So inshallah, we discussed at the beginning, when we started, the topic of ilm and knowledge. Then we went on to the topic of hadith. Now we move on to the kitab itself, the book itself. Inshallah, we will cover the kitab and the book by the name of Riyadhus Saliheen. What does it mean by Riyadhus Saliheen? The word Riyadh is a plural of Rawdah, Rawdatun. And Rawdah means garden. Rawdah means garden. And the word As-Saliheen is a plural of As-Salih, which means righteous and the pious people. What is this kitab about? What is this book about? In a nutshell, Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, the author himself, also discusses this in his introduction. This kitab generally does not discuss any masail, any ruling. It is a book of hadith, compilation of a hadith, more even for the awam and for the public, for the general public as well, where it is more related to the person's purification of the heart and also the building ikhlas, taqwa, tawbah, and all of these issues, these good traits of the heart, good characters. So by studying the kitab Riyadhus Saliheen, a person will have all the good characters and good qualities in his life, inshallah. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi starts with Babul Ikhlas and then he goes into Babul Tawbah, and he has many, many different chapters in there, inshallah. We will cover as many as possible even with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, inshallah, we're going to finish on a brief profile of the author. The author, his name is, he's known as Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi. What's his name? In short, his name is Yahya bin Sharaf. His name is Yahya, the son of Sharaf. Now we've got in the kitab, in the books, you've got his father, grandfather, great-grandfather. So Yahya bin Sharaf bin Murri bin Hassan bin Hussein bin Muhammad bin Jum'ah bin Hizam al-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi. So Yahya bin Sharaf al-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, in short. What is his laqab and title? Laqab and title are sometimes given to, you know, great personalities for certain reasons. So Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi was given the title of Muhyiddin Abu Zakariya. Muhyiddin means the reviver of deen, a person who revives deen. When you study his life and his books and his writings, you will understand how much effort he has put and how much work he has done for the deen. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi himself, out of humbleness, wouldn't like to be called this name, but the people and the public and the ummah use this title for Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, Muhyiddin. So we mention his name, Yahya bin Sharaf. His title, Muhyiddin, the reviver of deen. Point number three is date of birth. He was born in the month of Muharram, in the first 10 days of Muharram, in the year 631 after Hijrah. 631. And now we have entered into 1433. So anybody can do the calculation? How many years? 631 and 1433. Do you know who's good at maths? It's about 812 years. 812 years ago. Now imagine 800 years ago, he wrote this kitab, and 800 years down after, people are still reading and benefiting from his kitab. This is his ikhlas and his sincerity in his work. So in the month of Muharram, 631, which is around 812 years ago, he was born in a town called Nawa, which is in now the Syria, is part of Syria, is near Dimashq and Damascus. What did he do in his childhood? When he was young, from very young age, he was more inclined towards studying. He was different to other children. Normally, children have the naturally as well. You can say that they are more inclined towards playing, etc. But Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, from young age, he wasn't into playing. The other children would call him and try to take him to play, but he busy himself in reading or something like that. From the age of 10, he started studying his deen. And he started becoming hafiz around the age of 10 as well. So he would not like to play, would rather study. And you will understand near the end that the fruit of this, inshallah, at the end of today. So when he was a young age, there was a great sheikh at that time by the name of Yasin ibn Yusuf al-Marakishi rahmatullahi alayhi. He once saw him, Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, that he's seeing the other children playing and he's busy praying and studying. So he, through the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this far sight, it's called Basira, Ahlul Basira, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens things up for them. So he realized that this child is unique. There's something special about it. So he went to his father and he told him that, your child you have, make him study. Take him to do some ta'aleem. Take him out to do some learning. So his father also paid a bit of extra attention towards this. So he started studying at the age of around 10. His all the hadith and etc. and Quran at the same time becoming hafiz. And I think around the age of 17, 18, he was going to travel to Damascus. He traveled to Damascus. Dimashq at that time was a center of ulama and ilm. He was there for 1 or 2 years. Then around 651 AH, when he was around 21 years old, his father took him for Hajj. And at that time, obviously, the journey was long as well. So it took him several months, where they stayed in different places, and Makkah al-Mukarramah, Madinah al-Munawwarah, spent several weeks or months there as well. And he returned back to Damascus, where he spent quite a few years of his life studying. And after he finished, now when he used to study, he wasn't, just spend a couple of hours a day. No, he used to spend around so many hours a day that he would study 11 different subjects in one day. From young age, 11 different subjects in one day. Then later on, he returned back to his birthplace, Nawa. In his life, he wrote various books on various topics. For example, on Sahih Muslim, he wrote a commentary on Sahih Muslim. On Shafi'i Fiqh, he wrote a kitab by the name of Sharh al-Muhadhab. He wrote a kitab by the name of Al-Athkar, very famous. Then you've got the 40 hadith of Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, and you've got this other kitab, Riyadhus Saliheen as well. And when he, in the year 676, so this is at the around age of 45. So he started studying from 10 and he went to further studies, 17, 16. And at the age of around 45, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, put this in his heart and his mind that you're going to be leaving this temporary world very soon. When he noticed this and when he realized this, he met his teachers, gave the al-wida'i and the departure, salam and dua. He went to a few graves of his shuyukh as well, of his teachers. He met his family, he met his relatives, friends. He also went to Baytul Muqaddis. He went to the grave of Hadith Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And in Nawa, when he returned back to Nawa, in his where his birthplace is, he fell ill. This was the last illness which led him to leave this world. He left this world and he passed away on the night of 24th of Rajab, which was the night before Wednesday. So Wednesday night, 24th of Rajab, 676. So at the age of 45. So only 14 years he spent in his, for the deen. But think about how much work and how much effort he's put. Think of his ikhlas, and sincerity, and he didn't marry. He didn't get married. Why? He wanted to dedicate his life for deen and for studying. And he did this. That 800 years later, we are benefiting from his books. I think in Uzbekistan or one of those towns and those places, you know, we have in our area, we have a Sheikh al-Hadith. For those who are very familiar with the Darul Ulum system, those individuals who teach Sahih al-Bukhari, maybe cover to cover, and they've been teaching it for several years or more years, they are known as Sheikh al-Hadith. In that area, well, one of my Ustad, Maulana Abdul Rahim Sahib, he mentioned that when he traveled there, he goes down there, they teach Riyadhus Saliheen as one of the final books. So the level and the status of Riyadhus Saliheen in that area is different to here. So this was a brief profile of the author Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi. 45 years, very short life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a lot of work from him. Inshallah, if we also dedicate some part of our life, some part of the day, for the deen, with ikhlas, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take any sort of work for us, from us, that we are in our graves, but inshallah the knowledge and the children inshallah will be left behind, and any other means we leave behind for people can benefit. You know, the hadith says that in qata'a amal ibn Adam, that the amal and the actions of a human being and the servant of Allah finishes and cuts off, except few. For example, he leaves behind him pious children who make dua for him. He leaves behind knowledge, either his written knowledge himself or he contributed towards knowledge in any different ways. People are benefiting from that. Inshallah, this will be a means of sadaqah jariyah for him. Like that, we built a masjid, we built a well, something like that, that where people can continue to gain benefit from. We will be in our graves, but inshallah, the reward will continue. We will continue to receive the rewards. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, accept all his mehnat and the khidmat for the deen, and make him among the prophets, the pious ones, the truthful ones. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also to give us the ability to work and put effort behind the deen, and give us qabiliyat and qubuliyat, ability and acceptance. That we are given the ability and we are also given that skill and the understanding of to do the mehnat, and also be one of those who are accepted. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the correct understanding. Inshallah, from next week, we will go on to the introduction of Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi of the kitab itself. Then inshallah, we will start the kitab Riyadhus Saliheen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the correct understanding. Allahumma ameen. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Subhan rabbika rabbil izzati ma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursalin. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Before we finish, as we just heard after the salah, that our new year, 1433, has started after Maghrib salah. Now, there are some masnoon du'as which are recited at the time. Hilalu khayri, hilalu khayrin wa rushdin. Hilalu khayrin wa rushdin. Hilalu khayrin wa rushdin. Amantu billadhi khalaqak. Alhamdulillahi alladhi dhahaba bi shahri hadha kada wa jaa bi shahri kada. And then we have Allahu Akbar. Allahumma ahillahu alayna bil amni wal iman wal salamati wal islam wa tawfiq lima tuhibbu wa tarda. Rabbana wa tarda. ربنا وربك الله اللهم أدخله علينا بالأمن والإيمان والسلامة والإسلام ورضوان من الرحمن وجوار من الشيطان. The conclusion of this is, we ask King Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for khair, for goodness, for the coming year, for safety, and also for peace and faith and harmony. And at the same time, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our mistakes and errors that we may have made in the previous year. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the ability to make the most of our life remaining. Allahumma ameen. Jazakallah. Does anybody have any questions?